Hi guys, welcome to your grade 7, 8 and 9 analysis of Macbeth. This is probably going to be a lengthy video. If you need a more basic video about his character, then it's on my YouTube channel. I'm going to focus not on everything, because again that would make this even longer, but we're going to focus on some of the main quotations associated with Macbeth. Before we do anything in terms of the context of the play, you absolutely have to acknowledge or understand the great chain of being. The Elizabethan audience or the Jacobean audience believed in a divine hierarchy that existed. It was an order that was created by God. So in this hierarchy, kind of put it here, God's at the top and you've got your angels and your monarchs, and that's going to be important to us because naturally King Duncan. Then we've got our noblemen and then all the way down and to your animals and things like that. Now the issue you have obviously in this play is that Lady Macbeth and Macbeth are going to confuse or overthrow the order by attempting and being successful in terms of becoming royal. They are therefore punished, obviously, in terms of a religious way by eternal punishment, especially with regards to some of the references that Lady Macbeth makes. Macbeth is our tragic hero. This is a Shakespearean tragedy. Your tragic hero is always the same. Your Romeo, your Othello, your Hamlet. They always start noble. Now we know Macbeth is noble because at the start of the play he is actually described with that adjective. Our tragic hero is flawed by ambition. They have an ambition, or Macbeth has an ambition, and so does Lady Macbeth, that makes them royal. As I've just said, it's against the natural order. Our tragic hero was always fated to doom and to die. Macbeth was slightly different because other than being ambitious, he is also driven by the prophecy of the witches. And what happens then is he, as our protagonist, actually becomes our antagonist and he becomes our villain. In terms, again, of your Aristotle's tragic hero characteristics, Aristotle said a man doesn't become a hero until he can see the root of his own downfall. The tragic hero has a flaw, which is your hamartia. There's a reversal of fortune, which is your peripeteia, so that's the moment where our hero can't come back from it. There's a couple of instances of that in Macbeth, one being the killing of the king. Obviously, he can't restore order after that. The discovery and recognition, obviously, of what they've done, which is their anaphylosis. Excessive pride is your hubris, and then obviously fate interferes. When he's named the Thane of Cawdor, or the Thane of Glamis by King Duncan, it is King Duncan who calls him noble and brave and great. So look at your triple there, which I'm going to analyse in just a second. And the witches also tell him that he's going to be the King of Scotland. Initially, he's fearful of the predictions, isn't he? But then he obviously sides with them by the end. He also attempts to defy Lady Macbeth's persuasion. As I've mentioned, he's got the pride that Lady Macbeth insults, and she insults his manhood as well, doesn't she? In terms of your peripeteia, as I said, it's after the killing of Duncan, before Macbeth arranges the murder of Banquo and Fleance. That's the moment really where he can't come back, and you get that quote, "Iron and blood stepped in so far, that should I wait no more, return were as tedious as go over." I'm going to analyse that later on. And Neuragnorosis there is perhaps when he becomes aware that Lady Macbeth is dead, and his reaction suggests that he's defeated when he says a tale told by an idiot signifying nothing. So again, look at the fact that idiot and nothing in terms of your analysis. Perhaps another example of your anaphylosis as well is when Macduff reveals that he was untimely ripped from his mother's womb, because then again, as an audience, we realise that Macbeth can die. And obviously it's here that he learns, I suppose, the limit to his power, really. I'll not read that out for you, but if you pause the video, you'll have a look at that, because I'm obviously going to move on to analyse some of the key quotations. But it's basically Macbeth being consumed by guilt, and just some of the main themes like ambition. Again, pause the video here if you need some information there before I move to quotations. But again, it's just a little bit about plot, a little bit about his downfall. I'm going to move to the analysis now, so if you need a pen, grab it. We've got two adjectives at the start of the play, which are brave and noble. Now, I try to get my students to go literally and then move away. Noble is an adjective, it's distinguished by rank or title. So we know that he is a distinguished nobleman. And in your chain of being, the noblemen come under the monarch. Obviously, distinguished belongs to like a class of political status, but also, and I've put three stars there, so you can notice down, it's the aristocracy, the highest class. So again, it's more of a shock that Macbeth would then try and kill the king. Alternatively, though, it means exalted mental or moral character. Actually, what's going to happen to Macbeth once the witches have made their predictions is they feed his immorality and the values or the traits that obviously we shouldn't hold as human beings. So we get these connotations actually at the beginning that he is someone to be respected and admired. King Duncan, what he hath lost, noble Macbeth has won. So again, I put your context there. Look, the king is the most important person on earth. I want to say that again. The most important person on earth under God. And Macbeth and Lady Macbeth are going to be brave enough to murder him. And as I said, everything's got a place in the hierarchy all the way down. Macbeth is set up as a good soldier who is loyal to the king. Our lexical field here, or your semantic field, depending on your teacher, is about winning and losing in fortune and fate. And remember, it's the witches that are going to intermingle with that and influence what he does and the choices he makes. And King Duncan, obviously, is referring to the Thane of Cawdor being a traitor. So we've got our first introduction of appearance versus reality here. Massive theme, especially when we start introducing Lady Macbeth. And when we move to brave, again, we've got adjective possessing or exhibiting courage. Remember, in Act 1, Scene 1, we hear about Macbeth unseeming people from the knife to the chops. He's almost the hero, isn't he, at the beginning, who saved the war, a fine appearance. It is synonymous with a warrior, especially in North America. So the root word for brave is that North America has connotations of a warrior. So again, we've got this big image of Macbeth before we meet him. Brave, noble, great, loyal. Now, massive, and it's often missed, is his first words in the play are a parallel to the witches. He says, so foul and fair a deed I have not seen. There's a paradox there and a juxtaposition in foul and fair, exactly what the witches have set up. And it's showing us that they have already begun to influence him before they've even appeared. Foul and fair, obviously, are showing us the conflict that his character's going to face morally. When the witches use these words, though, it's more balanced because we get fair is foul and foul is fair. Look at that, it's like a balanced syntax. Look at the way the words are ordered. Whereas when he says it, it's a little bit more deceptive and a little bit not balanced. There's a bit of confusion there. So we know that the mental turmoil of Macbeth is being foreshadowed there. Ambition, remember, is a good value, but actually Macbeth's overriding ambition turns to something evil. Please pause the video when necessary, I do talk fast, there's a lot of information here. At 1 scene 3 we get, my thought, whose murder yet is but fantastical shakes, so my single state of man, that function is smothered in surmise, and nothing is but what is not. A long quote, I wouldn't expect you to remember it, but again, he's quick to jump to murder. He's quick to think of murder there, which the witches haven't actually mentioned. The fact that his first thought is about killing the king sets him up to be a little bit suspicious here. Or you could argue that it's awoken a murderous ambition in him. Still this, again, analysis. Shakes is a verb, can mean fall, it's something unsteady. It links to his later statement about falling down. So we've got this subtle foreshadowing of the witch's deception and the inevitability of the downfall of our tragic hero, Macbeth. When we get the metaphor smothered in surmise, as well, surmise means to think or infer without evidence. Well, that's what I've just said. The witches haven't mentioned murder. They don't mention Eunuch will kill the king. It's him that does that. So smothered in surmise is this idea that I'm inferring that I need to kill the king rather than being prophesied it. And then we get fantastical adjective, conceived or appearing as if conceived, unrestrained, imagination, odd, remarkable, bizarre, and even grotesque. So that adjective there, again, it's beyond realism. So this idea of something fantastical links to the supernatural, the influence of the supernatural, and their ability to, make him assume he has to kill the king. So a lot of information there. Please pause. This quote, again, key quote from Macbeth. He says, and notice that's an aside, so he's speaking to the audience rather than the characters. The Prince of Cumberland, that is a step on which I must fall down, I've just mentioned that, or else overleap, for in my way it lies. The stars hide your fires, let not light see my black and deep desires. Again, a long quote, take sections of it. So we've got his ambition being black and deep. So it sounds evil and malicious. Look at your adjective black. It's associated with the supernatural. Again, the question is whether we should let fate dictate our future or whether we should grab a hold of it. So remember, if Macbeth is fated to be the king, it will happen. But there's something about him that defies fate in the sense that he's not supposed to be a monarch. Now, your hidden desires, guys, links to the conscious versus the subconscious, which I'm going to come to. And this is this bit. So please have a pen ready if you're looking for grade 7, 8 or 9. Alfred Alder, okay, believes that dreams are emotional preparations to solve problems. So often disturbing common sense and giving way to something more private. So this is, remember, this is, he thinks dreams are linked to our subconscious. So the subconscious is our memory bank. And it's interesting as well because Lady Macbeth, remember, in Act 5, scene 1, when it says subconsciously, talks about the Fianna Fáil had a wife, where is she? So we get that access to her memory. And it's accessing the part of the brain that we're not fully aware of. And it's our desires. And it's again desires that aren't at the surface. So what we've got then is Macbeth's subconscious here, he is driven to want to be royal. And there's a huge juxtaposition between the two. Yeah, so the Macbeth we see at the beginning, the brave soldier, is not the Macbeth who subconscious wants to be the king. The Lady Macbeth we see at the beginning, whose conscious is at play where she wants to be royal, is not the Lady Macbeth we see at the end, where it's a subconscious and we see this really weak, fragile woman. Still on this quote, adjective deep refers to the subconscious. Something else is at play here, a deep ambition of Macbeth, an evil ambition perhaps, to killing the regicide. It implies that the witches have tapped into something deeper and something ominous. It parallels Lady Macbeth. When we then couple deep with the adjective dark, the adjective black, it sounds malevolent. Now, black in Gothic literature is linked to death, and in this play, it's linked to Lady Macbeth. She talks about the thick blanket of the night. There's a paradox between light and dark here, suggesting the inner turmoil of Macbeth, and it's similar to Lady Macbeth when she uses antithesis at the beginning of the play. If you need any of my Lady Macbeth videos, they're on the YouTube channel. There's about 3 or 4 there. Still on this quote, personification of the stars, look at the sibilance of the S. It emphasises the heinous nature of regicide. Deep suggests the extent of his ambition, really, really deep, deeper than we even thought. Hitting, remember that, they're the dream. But also the conscience of Macbeth suggests that he knows it's wrong. Rhyme, fire and desire connect his thoughts and his actions. Fire obviously is something aggressive. And the audience obviously would have believed as well that the stars controlled fate. So this idea when he's talking to the stars, is he asking fate to help? Is he asking fate to make him a little bit more malevolent? Still here on this quote, the juxtaposition of fall and overleap. The language reflects the future and fate is inevitable death, his inevitable downfall, the upsetting of the hierarchy to fall to overleap. Overleap means he knows he's defying the great chain of being. He's overleaping his position from nobleman to monarch. Literally, as I say, he's overreaching as our tragic hero. He is punished for that. Move on there. Too full of the milk of human kindness, Lady Macbeth, according to his manhood, straightforward. It shows us that she knows his character. But again, we've got to start thinking about what are we going to see. Now, she's scared that he's not ruthless, so not fine. But let's start thinking about the noun milk. It implies that Macbeth needs to be nurtured into committing regicide. A mother has milk in her breast and she nurtures the child. This idea here is that he needs to be nurtured and cared for into regicide by Lady Macbeth. It also has connotations of innocence, an innocent child who needs some milk, and it contrasts with the dark desires already mentioned by him. And then we start questioning, what does it mean to be a man? And remember, masculinity is a big theme, especially in the Jacobean and the Elizabethan society. Ambition, we know, is a massive theme. So we get this quote. Why do I yield to that suggestion whose horrid image doth unfix my hair and make my secret heart knock at my ribs against the use of nature? So he's asking a question here about whether or not he should go against nature. Human nature is being questioned, the act of murder. Now, again, analysis, pause the video if necessary. He's asking the prophecies, if it's good, why does he find himself contemplating the killing of the king? Is it unnatural? Is it right? Is it moral? Is it immoral? Now, again, look at your language. He actually describes it as a horrid image. Look at your adjective horrid. Again, it's got Gothic implications. It comes from your root word of horrible. And then again, when he goes further, he talks about it, when he fixes his hair, physical. He's physically changing, and this idea that his secret heart is knotting at his ribs, he's anxious, he's worried, still here. It foreshadows the notion that the witches are corrupting Macbeth. His heart and his hair are all moving and changing. They are physically, emotionally, spiritually, and mentally corrupting Macbeth, the prophecies. That are going to have a detrimental effect on him, affect and defect there, because it's emotional and it's physical, the effect that they're going to have on our protagonist, and they're going to transform him into our antagonist, our villain. We've got the juxtaposition of seated and knock as well, about the heart, seated and then it's knocking. So we've got the physical beginnings of distress and guilt. And it's an interesting phrase as well, against the use of nature, because of the immorality of regicide. He knows that he shouldn't do it, but the desire and the ambition is too much. And that's our fatal flaw, that's our tragic hero. We will proceed no further in this business, and false face must hide what the false heart doth know. Now, we will proceed no further in this business is when he tells her he's not going to do it. His language now mirrors her suggesting a unison between the two. Okay, his language mirrors her a little bit, so we see that they are unified, especially in this quotation. He also refers to the murderous business, exactly what she does through her euphemisms. She calls it dispatch, she calls it the deed, she calls it business. He does that as well in this scene. So is it denial that he uses euphemisms? Is it now the influence of Lady Macbeth? And this quote here, the false face and the false heart, parallels the flower and the serpent. And the use of the adjective false implies that he knows he isn't in line to have the crown. And also this idea of appearance versus reality, what they're going to show the king, what they're going to hide from the king, deep desire. The juxtaposition here between hide and know shows, again, appearance versus reality is very strong. He sounds like her, he mirrors her thoughts, her actions, her behaviour. So the witches and Lady Macbeth are really, really fueling Macbeth there. This here is also the limit of his power in this moment, because he actually goes back on that. But remember, it's the euphemism of business, and it's the pronoun of we, the unison of the couple. Hallucinations again. Pause this slide here, because it's going to link to the dreams and the subconscious, but visions and hallucinations obviously recur throughout the play. We've got the dagger and we've got the ghost of Banquo and things like that. And we've got to start thinking about, well, what does it represent? So we're going to start looking at that now. But if you need any of this information, pause. Back to that. I'm just reminding you of that information I've given you, because it's important about dreams being emotional preparation. Now, we're going to move to this massive quote. Most of the kids in England will probably use it. Is this a dagger which I see before me, the handle toward my hand? Let me clutch thee. Right, he starts talking to the hallucination of the dagger. He speaks directly to it as if two personalities are at conflict, conscious versus the subconscious, where he's asking to hold onto it, asking to grab it. So literally, he's trying to grab, but alternatively, it's to become tense with fright and panic. Clutch, the word clutch here. So grab or tense and panic. So we've got the juxtaposition again, physical act versus emotional. The ambition of the flaw is taking hold of Macbeth here, because he can't now suppress the desire, because he follows the dagger to the room. It also looks like he's asking for permission. Is this a dagger that I see before me, the handle toward my hand? Well, he's asking for permission from the supernatural, from God. Is he addressing the witches there? Is he addressing Lady Macbeth? Still on this quote, look at your Shazura. Okay, your Shazura there, if you've done poetry, your punctuation, it adds hesitation. So when he asks the question and then there's hesitation, it implies that, again, he's not overly confident about the act of regicide. And then the imperative come, massive link to Lady Macbeth when she says, come spirits, unsex me here. He's demanding that it comes. Look at it, he's transferring the blame for the murder to the dagger. When he starts seeing that come, let me clutch thee. So again, supernatural Lady Macbeth. There's an argument as well that Macbeth is the conscious of Lady Macbeth, that they are totally linked. So this is just an argument, you don't have to agree with me. I'm asking if Macbeth is the conscious and Lady Macbeth is the subconscious. So he's, we shouldn't really be killing. And she is like in a deep desire of, yes, we should really be killing. And this is the beginning of their disintegration. Because once he doesn't need her anymore, she spirals into madness. Lots to say, so please stay focused. At 1:7, I have no skirt to prick the sides of my intent, but only vaulting ambition which overleaps itself and falls on the other. So again, we've got vaulting ambition, fall, and overleap linked. So it's almost as if Macbeth is being honest with himself and confronting his conscience and arguing about reasons why he shouldn't and should kill the king. So again, this internal conflict, it's extended metaphor. The only reason for committing the deed is vaulting ambition. So this metaphor actually refers to horses. So please listen here. So horses and horsemen. Excuse me, I'm going to cough. This metaphor suggests an inexperienced and rather ridiculous rider, a horse rider, who tries to vault onto a horse and vaults so vigorously and violently that he goes over the saddle and falls on the ground. That is your extended metaphor. So as you can see, this is linked to Macbeth. He is so overly ambitious that he falls down because it's just an overstretch. So think about that. It's a mistake really, isn't it, to kill the king. Pause that slide if you need that horse metaphor there. Macbeth does murder sleep. Again, big quote. Literally references the murder in a Duncan because they do it in his sleep, so it's very cowardly. It sets Macbeth up to be a coward. He won't be able to sleep because he's so guilty, and it leads to his insanity. That also applies to Lady Macbeth. According to psychologists, so this is quite interesting, guilt is linked to the fear of exposure and punishment. So the thing of sleep is metaphorically linked to deeper psychological issues. So again, think about what Shakespeare is really showing us about Macbeth, other than a murderer. The murder of Banquo, massive quote, I love it, always tell my class about this one. Upon my head they place a fruitless crown put a barren sceptre in my grip, thence to be wrenched with an unlinear hand, no son of mine succeeding. So the prophecies make Macbeth suspicious about Banquo and his children. And therefore we've got that other influence of the witches that he then decides to kill them. Again, disorder is linked to the supernatural. Adjective fruitless, something that is unproductive, something that is useless without results or success. So when he then applies that to the crown, he knows the limit of his power. He knows his children will never succeed. Lady Macbeth knows their children will never succeed. And then we get barren. But more interestingly, a synonym of fruitless is sterile. That reminds us of Lady Macbeth because she references the fact that she can't have a child. So again, we see that their success is going to be short-lived. Barren, again, is that a direct link to her that she can't produce the offspring that they need and to solidify their role in terms of the monarchy? We have Scotch the snake, not killed it. Again, look, a big reference. Literally, Scotch is a verb which means to slice or cut. So again, we've got this almost gothic, violent type language. This means that they have wounded the snake, but they haven't killed it. The snake here is Banquo and his children. Remember, they get rid of Banquo, but don't get rid of Fleance. So they've wounded the snake, but it isn't dead. So I think we've got imagery of the Hydra here. If you haven't done Hydra in Greek mythology, the Hydra has many, many heads. And when you cut off one, more grow back. So again, killing Duncan has beheaded the snake, but until his line are completely eradicated, it will carry on. So the snake isn't just Banquo there, because Fleance has escaped, it's also Duncan's sons, because they've escaped. So the Hydra is obviously, it's grown more heads, but you've got to get rid of them all. Also, snake, I think, is loosely linked to the serpent by Lady Macbeth, and we know that that's got connotations of something sly. It links us to the downfall of mankind from the Garden of Eden. It links us to temptation and wanting what we can't have. All full of scorpions is my mind. Imagery of the scorpion. There's a few interpretations here, so if you're bored, don't turn off just yet, because this is going to be good. Scorpions inflict pain. Therefore, he is aware that his ambition is harming himself. But on the flip side of that, it also gives him the power to corrupt and inflict pain on others. So we've got two readings there. But symbolically, the ancient Egyptians thought that the scorpion spirit was a potent guardian for souls moving from one world to the next. So when you're thinking about that, is that the link that he's going to move to death and he's aware? If we carry on, African culture link the scorpion to death and life. The scorpion is a spirit that that creates change in the consciousness. That is exactly what we're talking about with Macbeth changing his consciousness to kill King. So we've gone from brave Macbeth to murderous, to the tyrant at the end. So the scorpion there that is in his mind represents a change in his stream of consciousness, massive quote. With this in mind, if the scorpion keeps appearing in life, you find your awareness starts to change. And in many settings, a scorpion has come to represent unexpected death. So we're talking about African culture. The scorpion represents quite a few things that apply to Macbeth. The fact that his death is unexpected. Well, he doesn't expect it because he doesn't think anybody has been timely ripped. Please pause that if you need it, because I think there's a lot in there. And the idea that his mind's full of them. He's plagued, he's infected. Carrying on. Nature shows us that the scorpion has an ability to protect itself. We know that. Look at its shell, and look at the fact that it's got like claws. Sorry, I'm not a biology teacher. It's got like a stinger on its tail. Unfortunately, this creature has poor eyesight. So a scorpion's eyesight isn't very good. Metaphorically, there we are, Macbeth. He can't see the consequences of his actions. There's your next link to the scorpion. Huge, guys, if you're looking for a 7, 8, or 9 here. And in the Greek story of Orion, being killed by the scorpion for his boastfulness, so that's bragging. We also see this as a creature that can mete out divine judgments. Again, linked to the notion that Macbeth believes he can't die. So in this story, Orion is like a bragger, he loves himself, he's full of himself. Macbeth is, he gets to that stage where he doesn't think he can die when he goes back to the prophecies. So huge link there again. This quote is huge, and you're probably thinking, she's silly, I'm never going to remember that. But if you just take out some of the key words, so if you want to press pause there, then absolutely do it. And it's the section about Banquo's seed being the next king. But the noun Rancus, put Rancus in the vessel of my peace, okay, means bitter, resentment, ill will, hatred, and malice. So we see, put Rancus in the vessel of my peace, your juxtaposition of Rancus and peace, and the idea that he's starting to hate Banquo. We get the imperative come, used again, come fate into the list and champion me with the utterance. He's begging fate to help him, reminds us of him earlier, reminds us of Lady Macbeth asking the witches to fill out the direst cruelly and things like that. And champion is an interesting word because it means a person who has defeated all of their opponents. So he's asking fate to make him the champion, to make him the undoubted king. For mine own good, all causes shall give way. I am in blood, stepped in so far that should I wait no more returning, were as tedious as go over. So we've got this huge imagery of Macbeth stepping in blood. Blood symbolic of guilt here, but the innocent lives destroyed. He actually believes, because he stepped so far into the blood, that it's easy just to carry on killing people than to try and go back. Look at our tragic hero, can't go back. This image links to the dictator, to the tyrant that is described at the end of our play. And this idea of him being stepped in blood shows us the severity of his actions, the death that he's caused. Thou canst not say, I did it, never shake thy gory locks at me. So this is the moment with Banquo's ghost. Adjective gory. Again, blood is symbolism here. It's used to show the disintegration of his mental and emotional stability. Adjective gory, stained with gore, involving bloodshed. Straightforward. Macbeth is hallucinating again. Metaphorically though, guys, the banquet feeling, so the feeling of his banquet, represents his psychological collapse. It also symbolises that he has broken the rules. Sorry, I missed an L out of there. He has broken the rules of society and the hierarchy. So the feeling of the banquet is, I suppose, the beginnings of the come down of anything Macbeth is trying to create in terms of a monarch. By the pricking of my thumbs, something wicked this way comes. Obviously the witches. I've got a rhyme couplet. It adds that sense of creating a spell. Shakespeare uses a different meter for the witches. Please check out my video on the witches and the supernatural for that. So where Macbeth speaks in the iambic pentameter, the witches have a trochaic rhythm instead. So if you don't know the difference, iambic pentameter is stressed then unstressed, your trochaic rhythm is unstressed then stressed. Now you obviously can be applying that to show that the witches are almost in conflict with Macbeth. The noun thing, Macbeth is no longer a human, look. Something wicked this way comes. So the witches have prophesied the idea that he has turned into this wicked tyrant. Also, there's a change in power and control here. The witches at the opening of the play summoned Macbeth. Sorry, I've missed the TH just gone down there. Sorry, that's my time. The witches summoned Macbeth to them, but now he goes to them. So you've got to start asking if they're just exposing his flaws, the flaws that were already there. How much influence are they really having? Do the witches control his fate? Context of this bit, it was customary to fold the thumb. So if you try this now with me, into the palm, like that, okay? And when you've done that, it was like a precaution against the supernatural. So when they start mentioning, by the pricking of my thumbs, we get this idea of a warning against the supernatural by doing that. And this links us to James I. Remember, James I was highly interested in the supernatural. So this idea of, by the pricking of my thumbs, something wicked this way comes, it's this notion of the audience of a warning against the witches and what they're seeing. Macbeth is yet to take heed of this warning though. And wicked is the simple adjective that you can do as well. Pause that slide if you need that information. Tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time, and all our yesterdays have lightly filled the way to dusty death. Right, this is when he hears that she has died. So remember, Lady Macbeth dies off stage. The repetition of tomorrow could represent the growing insanity of Macbeth. It also shows us that time is short-lived. Alternatively, he believes life is now limited. She's died. It seems that this is symbolic of a shining path to death. Dust has biblical links as well, referring to the storms of sands and dusts taken by Eastern travellers, which were often deadly. So again, when we're talking about dust, start thinking about your biblical link. The travellers from the east and his prediction of something deadly, starting to anticipate his own death. Sorry for the noise there, stay with me. Roman Firrell refers to Brutus. So if you haven't done Brutus and Octavius and Marcus Antony, then listen. Brutus was famous in history for running into his own sword. He ran into it. Macbeth sees a pointless taking his own life and dies in battle. Some critics argue that that's admirable because he dies brave going down fighting. But Brutus kills himself, Brutus kills himself so Mark Antony and Octavius cannot lead him through the streets as a traitor and kill him that way, torture him. Macbeth refuses to yield. Butcher, coming to the end, he's done really well here, guys, if you stay with me. Butcher, he's described the dead butcher and his fiend-like queen. If you need fiend-like queen, it's on my Lady Macbeth video. A butcher is a wholesaler in meat. It's a person who slaughters animals, a person guilty of brutal slaughter. So by using this, we've got the idea that Macbeth has ended this play in a brutal way, slaughtering people. When you link that to time as well, you've got this horrendous juxtaposition of the brave and noble Macbeth from the beginning of the play. If you do need anything else from my Macbeth video, please just go back, pause it where necessary. There's a more basic videos as well there. Sorry about the noise. There's 3 or 4 Lady Macbeth videos as well, grade 9 and things like that. This is by no means everything that you need because there's lots to see. It's just how do we hit grade 9. I hope this has been useful. Please check my YouTube channel for anything else. And massive good luck in your English literature exam.